more about how we can improve and better target our federal investment of funds in this area to help children who can most benefit from these services to receive them. Today, I'm pleased to welcome the following witnesses. Debra Andersen is the Executive Director of Smart Start Oklahoma and the Oklahoma Partnership for School Readiness Foundations. Smart Start Oklahoma is dedicated to improving early childhood policies that support all children being prepared when they enter school. Prior to joining Smart Start, Ms. Andersen was employed by the Oklahoma State Department of Health, providing state-level leadership for child guidance programs. Ms. Andersen has extensive experience in providing services to young children with communication delays, program planning and administration, and community coalition building. Walter Gilliam is director of the Edward Zigler Center for in Child Development and Social Policy, an associate professor of child psychiatry and psychology at the Child Study Center, Yale School of Medicine. He's on the board of directors of the National Association of Child Care Resource and Referral Agencies, and is a fellow at 0-3 and the National Institute for Early Education Research. Dr. Gilliam's research involves early childhood education and intervention policy analysis, ways to improve the quality of pre-kindergarten and child care services, the impact of early childhood education programs on children's school readiness, and effective methods for reducing classroom behavior problems and reducing the incidence of preschool expulsion. We may need you for Congress consultation on that. Diane Rauner is the president of the Ounce of Prevention Fund, a public-private partnership dedicated to advancing program and policy efforts to prepare children for success in school and later in life, among many other initiatives. In partnership with the Buffett Early Childhood Fund and other national philanthropies, the Ounce has built the EduCare Learning Network from one birth to five school on the south side of Chicago to a growing network of schools across the country, and launched the First 5 Years Fund, a federally focused advocacy and communication efforts. Ms. Rauner's also the First Lady of Illinois. I look forward to all your testimonies, and now I'd like to go to my distinguished ranking member, the gentlelady from Connecticut, for whatever remarks she'd care to make.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, and I join you in welcoming our colleague, Denny Rehberg, and it's wonderful to see you, and it was that we had the opportunity to be, if you will, we were the bipartisan baby caucus with its focus on infants and toddlers, which was established several years ago, where we did forums that dealt specifically with early childhood education and some of the issues that we will discuss today about the effect of abuse and neglect and violence against youngsters and what that means. So welcome. It's great to see you. I also want to say hello to Alan Lopatin, who's with 0-3, who has done an outstanding job in that organization and with its focus on our babies. And to Katrina Cat McDonald, who, Mr. Chairman, was a legislative director for me a number of years ago, and now she's with the First 5 Years Fund, which is one of the projects in Ounce of Prevention funds. So an audience today singularly focused on how we make a difference in the lives of our young people. I must say, Ms. Andersen, I was speaking to our colleague Lloyd Doggett yesterday and telling him about this because Libby, his wife, is at HHS, and she has talked so highly of the programs that you are engaged and involved in. So I want to say a thank you to our witnesses, because the work that you do on the front lines of early childhood development is not just critical for our kids, but it is about the future of the country. The Zigler Center carries on the legacy of the father of Head Start, Professor Ed Zigler, who I'm proud to count as a mentor, a constituent, and a friend. And we had the opportunity to honor him just a week or so ago. Ounce of Prevention has pioneered comprehensive early childhood education, including EduCare and home visiting, and we know what that means. And Smart Start Oklahoma has helped to position its state as an acknowledged leader in early childhood programs. So happy to have the opportunity for your views, and it's fitting that we're able to do so in the 50th anniversary year of Head Start. The chairman mentioned we're here to talk about the importance of early childhood development, the role that government can play in delivering high-quality programs to young children and their families. We will consider the investment made through three crucial federal programs: the Child Care and Development Block Grant, which helps working parents balance jobs with family life; preschool development grants help states make strides toward universal pre-K; and Head Start brings together all of the services that matter most to young children and to their families: education, health, emotional well-being, nutrition, social services, and more. Although it is a mandatory program and therefore not funded under this committee's bill, I'd like to mention the Maternal, Infant, and Early Childhood Home Visiting Program, which is one of the topics we addressed at the Baby Caucus. This is a program that does an outstanding job of improving the health of at-risk children and their parents. There is a growing momentum of evidence that early childhood interventions like these work. They reduce inequality. They narrow achievement gaps. Economically, they represent an excellent return on investment. We have Nobel laureate economist James Heckman and former Federal Reserve Chairman Ben Bernanke agreeing on this effort. Children who benefit from these programs are healthier, less likely to need special education services, to be held back a grade, or to get in trouble with the law. They're more likely to go to college and to have professional careers. A quick example: I recently spoke at the gala that honored Head Start and Ed Zigler as the father of Head Start. And Professor Zigler at the gala was reunited with an anesthesiologist, Dr. John Paul Kim, who had treated him at Yale New Haven Hospital. It turned out that Dr. Kim was himself a Head Start alumnus. His parents had been refugees from Cambodia, and he credited his success in life directly to Head Start. Needless to say, he was excited to meet the father of the program, even though applying the anesthetic to his hero was a little bit nerve-wracking, as he described. So it's not an exaggeration to say that among the kids who are enrolled in early childhood programs are tomorrow's doctors, the scientists, the engineers, the teachers, political leaders. As Professor Zigler himself has put it, and I quote, "If every child is a national resource, then every child's welfare is a national responsibility." And I would add, it's a national priority. There's simply no better way to spend our health and education dollars than to fund early childhood development, which is why these programs have long enjoyed support from both sides of the aisle. As I said, from the bipartisan Congressional Baby Caucus, where we do try to keep members up to date on the latest research and information. Overall, the programs have fared relatively well in recent years. Since 2010, we have grown Head Start's budget by nearly $1.4 billion, or 19%, although unfortunately, inflation has swallowed more than half of that increase. Similarly, we have increased the Child Care and Development Block Grant by $308 million, which is $125 million in real terms. And of course, we've created and funding the preschool development grants, and not to be self-serving, but I was very excited to be a part of that effort in developing these development grants. And in fairness, compared to the ongoing cuts that are devastating other priorities that are funded by this committee, this is good news. And it reflects widespread bipartisan agreement about the importance of early childhood education and development. But the measure of how much we need to invest is now how little we are investing in other areas. That's not the issue. It's the level of need for each program. And there are a lot of disadvantaged children who are not receiving the support that they need in order for them to thrive and succeed. Dr. Gilliam notes in his testimony, our investment in infants and toddlers has failed to keep pace with population over the past 10 years. Head Start reaches only 41% of eligible 3- and 4-year-olds. Less than 1/4 of low-income families have access to federally subsidized child care. As a nation, we are lagging behind key competitors. We rank 26th in preschool patient among four-year-olds, 24th among three-year-olds, and 21st in investment in early childhood interventions relative to the wealth of our country. And while the emerging powerhouses like China and India are committing massive increases in their own investments in this area, the President's budget request is a step in the right direction. A proposal of 18% increase for Head Start, 15% increase for Child Care and Development Block Grant, an additional $500 million for preschool development grants. This is good news for our country. I hope that given the overwhelming evidence in favor of these programs, we will be able to meet the commitments that the President has proposed. If we're serious about making early childhood programs available to all needy children and maintaining our competitive edge on a global stage, we must be willing to fund even bigger investments. Thank you all for being here, and many thanks to you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. So if I plus up this program enough, you'll vote for the bill?
We'll take that under advisement.
Very good. Very good.
But well, it's a good start.
Okay. Well,
it's a good start.
You look for the little clues you can find. it is genuinely good to have all of you here today. And again, as the ranking member pointed out, this is an area that's brought people together rather than divided them. And so we appreciate that very much. We'll deal with each of you in succession. Ms. Andersen, you're recognized first. Your full statement will be placed in the record, and you're recognized for 5 minutes for whatever comments you'd care to make.
Thank you, Chairman Cole, Ranking Member DeLauro, and members of the committee for this invitation to discuss early childhood education in Oklahoma and how Oklahoma and the federal government can work together to improve the quality and the availability of early childhood programs. Oklahoma is fortunate to have had leaders in our state who have long recognized that in order to achieve economic prosperity, we must begin with our youngest citizens. During the late 1990s, long before these conversations began at the federal level so rigorously, simultaneous efforts occurred to pioneer universal pre-kindergarten, statewide home visiting programs, and quality child care rating systems. Oklahoma is a model for today's federal early childhood agenda, and we believe strongly in a continuum of services that are needed to be in place to best support the needs of our young children. Your committee is considering appropriations on early childhood education and care to increase the Child Care and Development Block Grant in order to improve the quality and safety of infant and toddler care and to expand Head Start. In Oklahoma, infants, toddlers, and three-year-olds comprise 44% of all children receiving child care assistance and represent the majority of children who participate in year-round full-day care in our state. In 1998, Oklahoma was the first to implement a statewide quality rating and improvement system. Child care centers and homes that meet the highest quality levels are reimbursed at higher rates. Quality is important, and it is expensive. Effective quality standards need to be identified to ensure the investment in quality yields positive outcomes for children. The federal government can support states such as Oklahoma to identify outcomes for children who participate in high-quality programs and provide adequate funding to provide support to implement high-quality standards. Pre-kindergarten programs in Oklahoma are considered a grade in the public school system and are allocated funds based on the state aid formula. I believe that's a little different than how a lot of states implement their pre-K programs. In fiscal year 2014, the $313 million that were allocated for pre-kindergarten programs were funded through 47% state, 41% local, and 12% federal funds. Increases in Title I and special education that are being considered by this committee can help support Oklahoma in improving high-quality pre-kindergarten programs due to the nature of our funding. Oklahoma did not apply for the preschool development grant. However, federal supports to states for free preschool programs in the form of block grants could improve our ability to reach more at-risk 3- and 4-year-olds that may not be participating in universal pre-kindergarten programs in our states. Expanded partnerships are being explored currently in our state between public schools, child care, and Head Start programs. The recent reauthorization of the Child Care and Development Block Grant also creates opportunities for greater flexibility in Oklahoma to expand these partnerships. Early childhood in Oklahoma represents an array of services provided throughout a child's early years. Here's an example of two children in Oklahoma who are completing their first year of kindergarten. And these are very real examples of differences in experiences that our young children are participating in. Both were born to single mothers who had not completed high school. The first child's mother received home visiting services, ensuring adequate prenatal care, and delivered a healthy baby. Because this mother received coaching on providing positive parenting skills, the baby was talked to, read to, and mother and child developed a strong attachment. While this mother completed high school and job training, her child was cared for in a safe environment by well-trained providers with opportunities for play and development. The child received regular health and developmental screenings. At age 4, this child was enrolled in a pre-kindergarten program. She was healthy and ready to participate. Upon kindergarten entry, she was prepared, eager, and excited to begin school. The second child's mother did not receive adequate prenatal care or supports, and her baby was born prematurely. This mother returned to a minimum wage job 2 weeks after her baby was born. She struggled with depression and worked long hours. Her baby was fussy and lagged behind on developmental milestones. This child stayed at his neighbor's apartment while her mother worked. This mother's job made it difficult to get her child to a preschool program, and she lacked information about what programs were available. When this child enters kindergarten, she's scared, withdrawn, starts out behind, and is not able to keep up with her peers. By the end of the kindergarten year, the first child is ready for first grade, and the second child will repeat kindergarten. Unfortunately, in Oklahoma, by the end of kindergarten, we're not able to develop connections to understand the different experiences that each child had with their subsequent school success or challenges. Oklahoma is proud of its accomplishments, but unfortunately, we're not able to brag about our outcomes. Accountability is an important next step on our journey to building a strong early childhood system in Oklahoma. We know these programs work. We want to establish processes so that we can understand how the program participation has benefited children's outcomes. We're encouraged by efforts at the federal level to build partnerships across programs and look forward to continued support to ensure that all children have opportunities for the best possible beginning. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Professor Gilliam, again, you're recognized for 5 minutes. Your full statement will be placed in the record, so whatever remarks you care to make.
Mr. Chairman, Ranking Member DeLauro, members of the subcommittee, it's an honor to be invited to provide this testimony regarding our nation's investment in our youngest citizens and their families and their communities. I appreciate the increased investment Congress has made over the past several years in early childhood programs such as Early Head Start and child care during these tight budgetary times. As this subcommittee makes decisions about where to devote admittedly scarce resources, I urge you to increase funding to key programs for our youngest children. Babies are born with an amazing capacity to learn, and that learning happens within the context of meaningful human relationships. During the first 2 years or 3 years of life, neurons are being connected at a rate that far surpasses any other age period. At about 2 to 3 years of age, something else is happening. The brain connections that are not being reinforced through human interaction and exploration are pruned away. They die off. Rebuilding these connections requires years of neurological rehabilitation, and it is often not fully successful. This neurological rehabilitation is known by various names: special education, therapy, remedial education. It is very expensive, and in many cases, its need is preventable. Early care and learning programs should be an integral component of our nation's educational strategy. In order to avoid more costly fixes during the K-12 period and beyond, our strategy for keeping children on a positive learning trajectory needs to begin as early as possible, even before birth. Research shows that the positive impacts of early Head Start are greater when supports are provided to families during the prenatal months, especially when the supports are carried through to the preschool years. Both educational and economic research confirm common wisdom. Supporting and intervening early is far more effective and cost beneficial than waiting for problems to become more intractable and costly. Research by James Heckman has shown the greatest return on educational investment occurs during the first 5 years of life, especially the first three. Although preschool programs certainly support school readiness, their impacts and return on investment are greatly enhanced by access to high-quality infant-toddler supports. In other words, when it comes to maximizing our nation's educational investment returns, the infant-toddler years should not be our afterthought. They should be our forethought. Although my written testimony addresses several areas of early care and education, such as home visiting, early intervention for infants and toddlers and disabilities, and early childhood mental health consultation, I focus my verbal remarks on the crucial areas of early Head Start and child care. Early Head Start is one of the few supports directed specifically at the 1/4 of our infants and toddlers living in poverty. Unfortunately, it only reaches about 4% of the eligible children, 5% with more recent increases. Last year, appropriators provided funding for an exciting new direction for Early Head Start, forming partnerships with child care programs to increase access to and promote the spread of quality services in communities. The Early Head Start child care partnerships are a crucial effort to create cost-saving efficiencies in our overall system of early care and education. These programs are just getting started and will help infuse quality into child care programs from the ground up while increasing the percentage served. Yet, a full 95% of our infants and toddlers in poverty are still left out of this highly effective support. I urge you to provide additional resources to Early Head Start expansion and child care partnerships to reach these most vulnerable children. One of our largest supports for our youngest children and families is the Child Care Development Block Grant. CCDBG serves a very disadvantaged population of families, of which 52% are below the poverty line and an additional 26% are below the 150% federal poverty threshold. Over 1/4 of these children are infants and toddlers. When implemented at high quality, child care can have a meaningful impact on children's development, especially those from very low-income families. Last November, the 2014 CCDBG reauthorization passed Congress with strong bipartisan support, was signed into law, marking its first reauthorization since 1996. The 2014 CCDBG includes many highly essential fixes to our nation's child care system. It helps keep our young children safe by requiring comprehensive background checks and safety inspections. It dramatically improves quality, especially in infant toddler care, where the quality is typically at its lowest. And it provides consumer information so parents can make informed choices. These are all extremely needed fixes to help make sure that child care is beneficial to both the working parents and their children. But child care is facing a crisis. Funding has stagnated over the past decade, and CCDBG has never served more than 1 in 6 eligible children. Since 2003, funding levels have not kept pace with the rising cost of child care, decreasing in real value by about 20% over the past 12 years. As a result, since 2016, the number of children served by CCDBG has dropped by more than 300,000, enough children to fill every single seat in the massive University of Oklahoma football stadium nearly 4 times over. Infant care is more expensive than typical public college tuition in some states, including Connecticut and Oklahoma, and far beyond the means of many working families, yet subsidies in most states are below federally recommended levels, limiting parents' options for safe, good quality care for their babies. Although the fixes to CCDBG are extremely important for improving safety and quality of child care, these now mandated fixes do come at a cost. Without adequate funding to these improvements, states will be forced to further cut the number of children served. Working families most in need of child care will have even less access to it, negatively impacting their ability to enter or sustain employment as the economy recovers. In sum, our system of early care and education provides meaningful benefits to children and families and reaps a significant economic return. And with the recent passage of the 2014 CCDBG reauthorization, several much-needed fixes will greatly improve our system. But the overall effort is woefully underfunded, and the fixes themselves may result in even more children and families losing access unless funding levels are improved. Early care and education provides meaningful short, mid and long-term economic benefits. In the short and midterm, one, they help provide an opportunity for parents to maintain employment by making childcare more affordable, plus the early care and education system itself employs many providers and teachers. That's the number two. Underpaid workers who are likely to spend their wages immediately and locally to support area businesses. In the mid and long-term range, early care and education programs help close the school readiness gap and place children on a path towards greater economic success and subsequent employability, reducing later educational costs in remedial education and grade retention and increasing their own potential life earnings. Early care and education is one of the few federal investments that have been shown to yield these kinds of short, mid, and long-term economic benefits and public benefits. I urge you to continue to grow this wise investment. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ms. Rauner, recognized for 5 minutes. Your full statement will be placed in the record.
Chairman Cole, Ranking Member DeLauro, and members of the subcommittee, thank you for inviting me here today to testify as part of this important panel, and thank you very much for holding this hearing. In addition to serving as a practitioner, I have a business background, and I'd like to take this opportunity to speak with a business approach to investing in early childhood development. And again, for us all, that's birth to five or prenatal through age five. I spent a decade of my career in investment banking and private equity investing, so I do know a little bit about return on investment. And I came to the field of early childhood because of concerns about the huge social and economic cost of educational inequities. I chose to focus on early childhood development because we know, as my esteemed colleagues have described, investments in the first years of life are simply the most efficient and effective ways to develop human capital. With the right investments, human capital development can provide great economic and social gains for individuals and society. I congratulate the bipartisan effort to understand early childhood in this Congress, and I can tell you that there is nothing partisan nor political in investing in new parents, in infants, toddlers, and preschoolers to achieve better education, health, and economic outcomes. A wide body of developmental and economic research shows these investments make sense and dollars far above their original cost when put into programs and systems targeted to disadvantaged children. Data from a wide body of researchers give credence to this investment strategy. None is more solid than the empirical research by Nobel laureate economist James Heckman, who shows the economic value of investing in the early childhood development of disadvantaged children from birth to age five. Heckman's work has shown the power quality preschool has to change lives, increase productivity, and reduce the need for social spending. His Perry preschool findings show that every dollar invested in high-quality early learning for disadvantaged children provides a 7 to 10% return on investment in better education, health, and social outcomes, and reductions in remedial spending. In addition, Heckman's most recent analysis of the health effects of the Abecedarian Early Childhood Program in North Carolina illuminates the power of investing in comprehensive birth-to-five programs to permanently increase IQ, contribute toward greater academic and personal achievement, and prevent expensive chronic diseases such as obesity, hypertension, heart disease, and diabetes. These hard returns are based on rock-solid research, with Heckman accounting for all the variables that could create doubt. He adjusts for small sample sizes, control group pollution, and the incidence of chance. Few analyses of social programs have been subjected to this level of rigor. At our own network of EduCare schools across the country, we've seen firsthand how high-quality early education drives better student outcomes. The Ounce developed the first EduCare school in 2000 in Chicago. Soon after, we partnered with the Buffett Early Childhood Fund to create the EduCare Learning Network, and there are now 20 EduCare schools operating across the country. We rigorously evaluate our programs to collect information that we can use to improve our models. The language and school readiness scores of EduCare children far exceed typical achievement levels for children living in low-income households. In follow-up studies in Chicago and Omaha, we have seen these effects persist through third grade and beyond, and we see powerful effects on parenting. The outcomes I've cited are found not only in small demonstration programs. They're also apparent in early Head Start, Head Start, New Jersey's Abbott program, North Carolina Smart Start, North Carolina Pre-K, and state investments in Georgia, Alabama, Michigan, Oklahoma, and my own state of Illinois. But the key determinant in these programs is quality. As president of an organization that has served as a state and federal intermediary for over 30 years, I can attest that delivering high-quality programs at scale using public dollars is both possible and necessary. It requires a commitment to professional development, data systems, innovation, and continuous quality improvement. We don't need to reinvent the wheel. What we need is more federal investment in state and local innovation, and more coordination between current investments in early learning, maternal and child health and nutrition for disadvantaged families and children. And we don't need to wait 20 years to see immediate returns. Investing in Birth to Five programs pays regular dividends in milestone outcomes. Governors and legislators from red and blue states alike are investing more in high-quality early childhood programs and systems. The federal government should follow their lead to achieve significant returns. States and private investors and philanthropy cannot do it alone. There is an appropriate role for the federal government that is not intrusive, but highly catalytic and collaborative. One of the most important roles for the federal government is ensuring funds are directed at supporting and increasing quality. Consider home visiting programs, which increase the potential of two generations. Young parents learn to invest more in their children and more in themselves, with many learning how to navigate a return to school and the workforce while providing a home environment that prepares their child for school and success in life. The Federal Maternal Infant Child Early Childhood Home Visiting, MICVE program, is designed with a high degree of accountability. Funding is allocated only to evidence-based programs, and states are required to report improvement on a range of benchmarks. Your recent support to extend this critical program is much appreciated. Recent reauthorization of the Child Care Development Block Grant will help parents work while their children receive higher quality care that stimulates their physical, emotional, and cognitive growth. Specifically, a $370 million increase in discretionary funding for CCDBG will help ensure that the goals of increasing quality in the new act become a reality and that parents receive the support they need to meet their child's early education needs. The case for increasing federal support for Head Start and early Head Start could not be more evident than when noting that less than half of eligible preschool-age children are able to participate in Head Start, and only 5% of eligible infants and toddlers receive early Head Start services. And the additional increase of $150 million for the early Head Start child care partnerships will spur even greater partnerships between child care providers and states, local governments, and public and private entities committed to meeting elevated quality. Finally, preschool development grants build on state-driven momentum to expand quality preschool opportunities for four-year-olds from low and moderate income families, including children with disabilities. Support for this program at $750 million will allow for currently funded states and new states to partner with the federal government to develop and expand the quality state-based preschool programs that help prepare children for school and reduce the need for expensive special education and remediation. Investing in quality early childhood developments clearly makes dollars and cents. Thank you very much. I'm happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. Appreciate, again, all of your testimony. If I can, Dr. Gilliam, I'll start with you. And as I mentioned to you in our conversation before we began the session, you know, one of the concerns that we hear when we talk about these programs is a lot of the gains that appear early seem to disappear sometime around the third grade. So as I told you, that sometimes raises more questions to me about what we're doing in K through five than what we've done before children were coming and going through early childhood education. But I'd like to get your thoughts on that. I mean, how do you make sure that whatever gains do occur actually continue to occur?
It's a great question. It's one that I get a lot of. In terms of the fade out and what the fade out actually means, when I'm asked this question, I'm trying to find a way to sometimes describe it to folks. I remind them that most things in life do have a fade out. Things do fade over time if you do not sustain the effort that you originally put into it. One good example of that is dinner. Every time I eat dinner, the next morning I find myself hungry again. Dinner has a fade-out effect, but that doesn't mean I'm not going to eat dinner tonight. You know, I'm going to eat dinner, then I'm going to make sure that the next morning I'm going to get my breakfast, too. When it comes to thinking about sustaining the impacts, one of the things that we've learned from a lot of research is that the efforts that you put into early childhood tends to reap benefits for the later educational experiences because it makes the later educational experiences more efficient. However, if the later educational experiences that are following are of extremely poor quality, then it is possible that you could actually wipe out a lot of the benefits that you've made before. It's not possible to ever take care of a seedling well enough that that seedling will be able to survive drought conditions later on. You know, and in many of our young children, unfortunately, when they're growing up in poverty, are being sent to schools programs that they're not going to be able to sustain those. Now, that doesn't mean that the early intervention program failed. It just means that we failed them, those children, to be able to sustain those impacts later on by making sure that we are matching those with adequate supports later.
May I also?
Yes, please do.
I'd also like to add that while we see fade out in academic skills, reading and math skills, what we see as well over the long haul is that children who have attended Head Start and early Head Start perform better than their peers in life outcomes, mm-hmm. in long-term life outcomes. And we suspect mm-hmm. that this is due to the long-term effects of the building of self-regulation and executive function skills that persist over lifetime. What we know, and we've seen this as well in larger studies like the Tennessee Star Study, which Roz Chetty and his colleagues performed at Harvard, of the Tennessee Kindergarten Study, is that while academic effects fade out over time, high-quality experiences early in life continue to pay dividends. So it may be a question, really, of what are we measuring and what kinds of effects are we expecting? We know the most important effects have to do with approaches to learning, self-regulation and self-control, persistence and motivation. These are skills which we all draw on throughout life. And it turns out that children who have had Head Start perform better in the long term in ways that suggest that those are the most important things that we're doing in the first years of life.
Thank you. Ms. Andersen, one of the challenges, obviously, if we're talking about increasing access and increasing the number of people that achieve these services, is simply the workforce that will be required to handle them. Where do you find the workers? What are the programs that you would favor that would make sure that we had, you know, if we were able to make, you know, ramp this program up, actually have people in place that could be beneficial to young people?
That's always a challenge. Finding enough workers that have adequate training to provide the kind of daily interaction with children to make sure that we do have high quality programs. So it's a combination of ensuring that those that provide services are adequately paid. That is one advantage to Oklahoma's pre-K program through the public schools. Those providers are compensated similar to a public school teacher. And that definitely has been a recruitment tool to get individuals to provide those pre-K programs. Sometimes that's been a detriment to our Head Start programs because we providers tend to sometimes move from Head Start once they get a bachelor's degree and then move into a public school program. Oklahoma does have 4 EduCare centers in the state, and those also attract and pay adequately for providers. And if we could look at providers across all programs, having the right kinds of qualifications and appropriate pay, I think that makes the job more attractive. There's a number of individuals who want to go into early childhood, but don't see that as economically viable for them, for their profession. And I think we're seeing a decreasing number in our universities right now with individuals who are enrolling in early childhood education. And it's something we definitely need to think about as the workforce overall in our state.
Thank you very much. May I add to that also? I mean, I guess we're starting a culture here of adding to each other.
That's okay.
But in terms of how to really sustain a high-quality workforce, one of the things that we really haven't been paying enough attention to is coaching and consultation for our teachers. We teach, and this is not just a point for early education. This is K through 12. This is higher education. This is anywhere where you have teachers. We teach teaching, and we think of teaching as if teaching were an academic subject. As if teaching were like math or history. Teaching is not an academic subject. Teaching is a performing art. And we really need to be training our teachers the way you would train a performing artist, by getting on the stage with them and coaching them through the actual motions of it. And there has been some research that's been conducted that suggests that if you put a coach in there in the early care and education program with the teacher, the amount of gains that it provides in terms of that teacher's ability to be able to do a good job is far better than anything that we can provide in pre-service training. And so it's really one of the things that we should be looking into.
Thank you. And I move next to the gentlelady from Connecticut. Thank you for being generous and allowing me to run a little bit over on my time.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Just to add to that point, there was just a recent article in the New Haven Register early in March, a mental health report. Special training support can be key to infants' mental health. In terms of what you're talking about and the high quality of individual that is needed in order to be able to interact with our youngsters, this is an additional layer of training that has surfaced as being critical. It tens of thousands of Connecticut infants and toddlers are at risk for social and emotional problems, and the professionals who interact with them most need mental health training in order to help them. That's a report that was just issued. So the training of those teachers, the compensation of those teachers, of utilizing a coach in these processes are really critical. Dr. Gilliam, let me just focus on a couple of things which involve both what you and Ms. Rauner have talked about. Almost half of the babies and toddlers in this country live in families that are poor or near poor. Mm-hmm. Dr. Pam Cantor, who was dealing with the turnaround program in New York, talked about the grinding effect of poverty and what that means to youngsters. I'm interested in a couple of pieces here about the comprehensive services that are offered by Early Head Start in two ways. Those youngsters who are vulnerable to trauma in the home, abuse, neglect, poverty, homelessness, parental depression, other mental health difficulties. What does the research and what does the impact of early childhood have on those youngsters? Coupled with that are the non-cognitive skills, which you made reference to, Ms. Rauner, that growing up in poverty, et cetera, reinforcing that. What are we doing through early preschool programs to deal with those comprehensive services for which early childhood is famous for, to provide the non-cognitive skills that youngsters need in order for them to succeed and probably not getting fired from school in terms of preschoolers, Dr. Gilliam. So let's talk about the abuse, the neglect, et cetera, and early childhood, and then the non-cognitive skills portion of this.
Either one. Many of our children are being raised in poverty or in near poverty circumstances where their parents are staying out of poverty because they're working very long non-traditional hours. Either they're in a single family home where the parent is working, or they're in a dual family home where both of the parents are working. It's not as much the poverty, it's the stuff that goes along with the poverty that hurts. It's the domestic violence, it's the drug and alcohol abuse, it's the community violence. These are not things that every impoverished child faces, but it's something that a lot of impoverished children face. Though when we think about comprehensive services and Head Start, people refer to that as thinking of the whole child services. But I would say there's really not just the whole child, it's the whole child, it's the whole family, it's the whole community. And that's one of the things that Head Start has been doing brilliantly for 50 years, is realizing that when we're talking about really young children, it's not about providing them math tutoring at 3 years old. We're talking about making sure that all the supports are in place that are able to ameliorate or at least mitigate to some degree all these negative life impacts that are going to happen as a result of that child being exposed to poverty. A lot of that's directed to the child. A lot of it's directed to the family.
And I'll just add, early Head Start programs and Head Start programs, when we talk about comprehensive services, these are really two-generation programs. And at their best, they are programs where, of course, the focus is on the child's development, but also on the parent's development. And we know that most of our parents are becoming adults as they're becoming parents. They themselves have not had the kinds of experiences and had the kinds of homes where they understand intuitively what they should be doing with their own children. So part of what we do a lot of in our programs is coaching and mentoring. We give parents, we build relationships with parents in which it's possible to talk about things like discipline, nutrition, the stresses that they as a family are under, and frankly, very basic things, including math. You know, one of the things that we started in our program was a family math night for infants and toddlers. And you might be asking what that is. Well, if you think about singing songs, that's pattern recognition, that's the foundation of algebra. If you think about setting the table, that's one-to-one correspondence. Teaching parents that they are their child's most important teacher is one of the most important things that we do in high-quality early programs like Early Head Start and Head Start. And it is the thing that sustains the intervention going beyond the fifth year. I mentioned that in EduCare, we do not see the kinds of academic fade-out that we have seen in other studies. And we know that that is because of our parents. We know our parents are sustaining the intervention. They have internalized the values of education and of their own capability to advocate for their children and to be their child's leader and coach and nag throughout their lives, which is what we all do with our kids. And that's why those children continue to succeed. We've seen that in our data, and we've seen that from comments that the teachers tell us about those kids.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. We'll next go to the distinguished Vice Chairman of the Committee, my good friend from Arkansas, Mr. Womack.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. My thanks to all. I'm a proud grandparent of a nearly 22-month-old and an 8-year-old, and I recognize the value of early childhood education. I think that everybody up here on this dais probably will agree on the merits of investing in our children very, very early. For the director in Oklahoma, as mentioned in your testimony, evidence shows that the investments made early have a great impact on long-term achievement, even despite the fade-out that was talked about earlier. I'll come back to that. There are a couple of studies that we commonly tout when discussing the virtues of expanding access to preschool and the value of early intervention, the Perry Preschool and the ABC Darien projects. But since the 1960s and 70s, when these studies were conducted, federal investment has grown dramatically. In fact, a 2012 GAO report says that there are actually 45 programs that provide or support services for children 0 to 5. So here's my question. What work has been done to identify key programs that create the greatest difference in a child's life as applicative ones?
Thank you, Mr. Vice Chairman. That's a question that we get frequently. especially from our business leaders in the state. We have a network of about 60 business leaders that are interested in investments in early childhood and want to know what are those that we need to highlight as the strongest investment. That's a very, very difficult question to identify. Every family is different. Every child's circumstance is different in that family. There are a number of well-researched programs that we implement in Oklahoma. We value evidence-based, we value research, we value high quality with the services that we provide. The menu that every family needs is a little bit different based on their individual needs. The two teen moms that I talked about who gave birth before they had completed high school have a very different path that they need as supports for parents and the kinds of things that are going to help their child be successful in school versus a child who may be born into a two-parent, college-educated, working one or both parents in the workforce. While we have several programs that are universal, such as our pre-K program, we have not enough programs that target families with higher need to make sure that we can best meet the needs for that family based on what we have available. We have just launched in Oklahoma what we're calling Parent Pro, and we're putting all of the home-based services under one umbrella. So if a family says, yeah, I really could use some home-based supports, I'm interested in somebody coming and visiting me, we are trying to do a better job of coordinating those different models of home-based services to make sure that we can match the right level of intensity with the need of the family. Some families need more intense services, other families don't. I would hate to say that there's any one or two things in early childhood that are the only things where we should invest our dollars. I do believe strongly that kids having a good start, those infant toddler years, parents being equipped with capacity to be their child's nurturer and good teacher are very, very important investments that we're not probably investing in as much in. But I wouldn't do that in lieu of having a four-year-old program where children have that opportunity to develop those non-cognitive skills, those kinds of skills that prepare you to be able to be successful.
I know I'm about out of time. I have one final question, and I'll just throw it out on the table for anybody, and that is how can we be sure that we're giving the same opportunities in early childhood education for rural kids? And you know, I come from a state that's got a lot of rural kids, Oklahoma, a lot of rural kids, as opposed to those in the more built-up areas and the more urban areas. How can we be confident that the opportunities are the same given the difference in circumstance?
I'll try to take that because, of course, in Illinois, we have very rural communities as well as, of course, large cities. And that's one of the places where a strong state system can make all the difference. Having a strong state system that can do asset mapping, can bring coaching and professional development to programs across the state, and can provide adequate funding to programs in rural areas that will not have the economies of scale or the capacity of a large city is, again, that's the province of a strong state, and that's where something like the preschool development grants have great potential because they're given to states to build their infrastructure and their capacity.
I appreciate the testimony. I've got to move to another hearing, but I'm glad to hear that better state control, that's something that I think a lot of us would agree with, is giving the opportunity for our states to make these decisions based on what the needs of those particular states are. And I thank the panel. Thank you so much.
Thank you. We'll go next to the gentlelady from California, Ms. Lee.
Thank you very much. Good to see both all of you. And really do appreciate your testimony and all of the work that you do each and every day to make sure that our young people have a future, and that's what this is about. I guess, I'm concerned, first of all, we're talking about now Head Start. This is 50 years later. Head Start was one of the Great Society programs, which President Johnson actually initiated. And one of the concerns I have, and I think Ms. Rauner, is it? You mentioned the numbers in terms of only 4% of eligible children right now today are enrolled in Head Start. Yet we've all talked about and know what the benefits are. of Head Start. So my former district director was a graduate of Head Start. Children of color, low-income children have benefited tremendously from Head Start. One of the concerns I have now, of course, is a result of the draconian budget cuts over the last several years. And if we're only at 4% now of children enrolled, how do we get to and reach the numbers of children that should be enrolled? And how do we address that within the context of this budget? Because 4%, I mean, 50 years later, only 4%. So how do we get there? Because we all know that it's early childhood education is a key to ensuring that children do not fall into poverty as adults, and it's a way of lifting children and families out of poverty.
Well, thank you for raising that. I think we would say that while the investments that are proposed before you are large, they're not that large relative to the size of the challenge. And certainly in the case of infants and toddlers, when we know, again, the returns on these investments, we believe very strongly that the investments that are proposed in early Head Start are but a starting point, really, for the need that we need as a country.
Starting point, but how do we move past the starting point 50 years later?
That's definitely a challenge and something we grapple with quite a bit in Oklahoma. We currently serve in our four-year-old program 74% of the four-year-olds in public school pre-K programs. We serve about 12% of our four-year-olds in Head Start. Some of those, the 74% and the 12%, are being served currently in what we call a collaborative classroom. So we have had many, many school districts, because of our rigorous four-year-old programs, join forces with Head Start programs, and they are co-locating services in a public school or in another community setting, predominantly in public schools, where they're sharing resources, sharing teachers, and that has allowed us to do two things. One, expand access, but also there's some things that Head Start brings to the table that the public schools don't always incorporate, and much of that is the family support and the encouragement that Head Start can provide and outreach to families. So we have found that to be a successful model. It's a difficult model to maintain and sustain, but it certainly has helped us get a number of our four-year-olds into that kind of a setting.
Along those lines, a few years ago, I released a report where I was looking nationwide at all the state-funded pre-kindergarten programs and Head Start and child care programs, because in many cases these fundings are braided together. And about 17% at the time of all Head Start grantees were a public school. This is building on the point that you're making. And when we looked at the strengths of Head Start, you basically got what you would expect, a lot of focus on comprehensive services that these low-income children absolutely needed, lots of focus on parent involvement. But the program struggled in terms of access to the kinds of supports that are typically found in a public school building, such as the access to guidance counselors and school psychologists and things like that, special education services. And the teachers were undereducated and undercompensated in comparison to the public schools. And the public schools were the absolute opposite. But when a Head Start grantee was a public school, you tended to have the best of both worlds and the weaknesses of neither. And in terms of the question that Mr. Womack was asking before about how do we find redundancies, to some degree, the redundancies are inherent and built into our system by keeping these as separate silos. What we really need to be doing is finding better ways to be able to integrate these programs together. But the integration can't just simply happen by having funding that can equally be tapped. There has to be some real conscious effort placed into it, because what we basically have at this point is a difficult to navigate siloed system at the federal level that gets reiterated at the state level, and then it relies on very courageous local people who are willing to do things sometimes that they're not quite sure are legal in order to collaborate. Else you end up with a hallway where you have the program for the poor kids on one side and the program for the really poor kids on the other side, which is certainly not something that any of us would want.
Go next, the gentleman from Tennessee, Mr. Fleischman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I want to thank all of you all for being here today on this very important topic. I'm a very strong supporter of early learning and the tremendous positive impact that it has on children's lives. As you know, some studies indicate that a person with preschool education is less likely to drop out of high school, get arrested, repeat grades, and require special education services. I think we all can agree on these are all good things. I have a few questions, though, for anyone who wants to answer this or cooperate on the issue of universal preschool. Concerns have been raised that universal preschool would unnecessarily subsidize people who can already afford to pay for it and place the burden on other taxpayers. My first question, could you please tell the committee what you see as the major risks and downsides of pursuing an across-the-board approach to preschool?
Well, I'll start. I think the biggest risk is that we underinvest in the infant toddler years. And certainly it's really important to create a prenatal through age 5 system that targets the most at-risk children first. We have to be sure that we don't expect preschool, 1 year of preschool, to address all of the challenges of being born into poverty. We know that the brain is built from the bottom up and that the first 1,000 days of life are the most critical for building a foundation on which to build great learning skills.
And I appreciate that, but on the issue of subsidizing those folks who can afford to pay, obviously we have a lot of folks who can't afford to pay, but subsidizing those who perhaps could afford to pay.
More specifically to the question that you're asking, I mean, there's nothing inherent within the concept of universal preschool education that would suggest that it means that you couldn't have a sliding fee scale. And that some families could pay when they are able to pay, and then other families wouldn't pay as much. And indeed, some systems are set up that way. There is a benefit to having universal access to preschool programs, and that's a benefit that's been shown in a few studies where it suggests that the low-income children who are in classrooms when there are more advantaged children in the classrooms tend to have better language gains. And the reason why is that if you spend any time in a preschool program, you can tell it for yourself. The majority of the words that children hear are not from the teacher. They're from the other children. And so if you can mix in middle class children in there, it's probably good not only for the middle class children's families in terms of their own child care, but it's also good for the program itself in terms of the benefits you're going to get from it. But it doesn't necessarily mean that those middle class children or the upper middle class children would get it for free. They could pay on a sliding fee scale.
Okay. Thank you. Also, could you please provide the committee with further detail on how universal preschool would make children school ready? What are the lesson plans? What are the skills they are learning? And what are the teacher qualifications? And so I know with our time, I say the green light, but my final question for you all will be, and then finally, how would the success of universal preschool programs be measured?
I'll take a stab at that. We have long recognized a need in Oklahoma to improve our measurements around our pre-K programs and better understand the preparedness level of children when they enter kindergarten. Many states are implementing measures. Oklahoma has not yet. That's one of our largest priorities, is better understanding what children are gaining in pre-K and how that impacts their kindergarten readiness.
I can add that many states have begun kindergarten readiness assessments, which in the best of all worlds will be multi-domain assessments. They'll look at things like language development and math skills. They'll also look at social emotional development, physical development, approaches to learning. These measurements, when done statewide, can really begin to benchmark differences between low income and middle-income children in terms of school readiness. They can look at the differences between rural and non-rural children, between races, and hold states accountable for improvements in closing those achievement gaps, again, before children enter school.
And that's when it's done sensitively, although there is a danger to all of this. And the danger to this that I've seen in some states is that they may be using kindergarten entrance exams with the intent that they're going to then figure out which preschool that child went to before and identify which ones are doing a good job and which ones are doing a bad job. The problem with that is that the benefit that you will get from it is nowhere near as strong as the likely problems that you'll get it from it in terms of a negative side effect. The negative side effect is the predictable one. The director who's struggling for resources will only want to serve the children who are likely to do well on tests, which basically means that the children who are most in need of the preschool programs won't be able to find one, especially a high-quality one, because those programs will want to look good on the test next year in the kindergarten level. And so anytime we think about these policies, we have to think about what is the intended impact that we want, and then what is the way in which this policy is likely going to become gamed, and which one is stronger, our intended, hoped-for impact, or this negative side effect that you could potentially end up with.
Thank you all very much. Mr. Chairman, I'll yield back.
Thank you. Go next, the gentleman from Pennsylvania, Mr. Fatah.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And I thank the chairman for hosting this hearing and the ranking member. It brings back some memories. Rosa and I had an event that we put together with George Miller a few years ago, and we had one of the leading experts on pediatric brain development. A young man from Vanderbilt was saying that actually in the third trimester, about 700 times a second, these neuronal connections are taking place. And it's critically important that we understand the brain in its development as an architectural circumstance, and the more that's done early, the more obviously will be able to be done later. And this pruning that you speak of in the kind of 2-4 frame is important to note. So I would start in a, you know, the Pew Trust is based in my district. They've been really involved in a lot of the states that have been mentioned. At a point, Mr. Chairman, they weren't really involved in Pennsylvania because our state wouldn't take the decisions like Oklahoma and some other states took to prioritize early child education. And then when Governor Randell came in, we got headed off in the right direction. But our country has got some challenges. So we've fallen in terms of the nations with college-educated adults, even though through the work of this committee and this administration, we've got 1 million more young people in college now today, and we kind of got the needle headed in a different direction. But we have more job openings than we've ever had in 14 years, but we have some skill deficits in terms of filling them. We got a lot of challenges as we face billion-plus populated countries economically, like China and India. So these discussions that used to be about, you know, what are we going to do to help children, really are now really about what are we going to do to make sure that America can retain its leadership position in the world. We cannot afford to leave these children behind, no matter what their circumstances of birth. Every possible thing that needs to be done if America is going to hold its position in terms of world leadership. And so this really is a discussion about investment, and it's about common good. My colleague asked about, you know, what would it mean if we did something universal. We do a lot of things as a universal base. We've got to do common defense. We do public highways and airports. We can do a lot of things that benefit the society. And I think that we have to see this this impulse in terms of early child education as something that's a public good. It's really not about the family and their ability to see the value in early child education. The country's got to see the value. And we have to make sure that that the utility of it is better understood by parents, and then I think they'll take advantage of it, but it also has to be available. So, you know, nationally certified child care centers are scarce. There's a dearth of them. So there are plenty of places where you can drop a kid off. Doesn't necessarily mean that they're going to get the best services that they should get. And we need to figure out how to make the improve quality and improve access. So I think that the chairman, in terms of holding this hearing, is a great place. It should be, and there is a lot of common ground that we need to take the work we've done over 50 years with Head Start and see it as a kind of floor for what we should be doing, and we need to improve upon it. So I just want to thank all of you for the work that you're doing. And as we're thinking about it as appropriators, we have to make some choices here. In terms of the budget request from the president, I know through your comments that you didn't really lean in on the question of money. This is an appropriations subcommittee, and we have to make some choices, and it would be wonderful to hear from you about what you think vis-a-vis the work we have to do in terms of marking up this bill and where you think the balance, the trade equities are in terms of the numbers that we should be looking at vis-a-vis the president's request. So, and all of you can jump in.
Well, I'll just say that we are firmly in support of the president's proposals. And again, these are, while they're large numbers, relative to the need and to the challenge that's before us, they are not that large. In fact, they're just the beginning, and they're just a drop in the bucket. So I think it's really important to acknowledge that while the proposed investments in the president's budget are large, they are nowhere near as large as the need for these services.
I'd like to say how much I appreciate your comment about global competitiveness. I do a fair amount of work not only in the United States, but also in China and in the United Arab Emirates and some other countries. And I can tell you this, we spend a fair amount, and this is probably going to sound like heresy coming from an academic, but we spend a fair amount of money in the United States studying children. And many other countries don't spend so much money studying children. What they do is they read the American research and they spend their money implementing what the research says. And it's amazing how much we are exporting our know-how on early childhood to other countries. We are basically manufacturing our own Sputnik moment right before our eyes when it comes to early childhood. When it comes to appropriations, I would echo what Diana just so eloquently stated, but I would also add to it that one of my concerns that I have right now is that CCDBG in specific has some amazing, terrific fixes in place that needed to have been in there for a long time. But the concern that we all have to keep in mind is that the fixes in quality will come at a cost. And if we don't fund that up to the adequate level, then the quality costs are going to cause massive amounts of access difficulties. You know, and so one of the things that I would really focus on is making sure that the tremendous work that was done on CCDBG when it achieved just massive amounts of bilateral support in Congress in both chambers is really being able to be appropriated so that the successes that we got with CCDBG aren't going to ultimately end up with access failures.
I would just like to build on that. I definitely agree that we need to adequately fund CCDGB so that we can have the quality, the availability. It's tough on childcare providers in our state to meet quality standards. We have very rigorous quality standards in Oklahoma. And as I said earlier, quality is expensive. And they need to be able to have the supports to be able to maintain that quality and run a business. And that helps ensure that our children who are being supported through child care subsidies do have access to high-quality centers. We have so many, talking about the rural issues, we have so many small towns in Oklahoma that it's very difficult for a center to operate at the quality expectations that we want to see for our children in subsidy. Along with that, the reauthorization does help us think about forming those partnerships with Early Head Start, and that is incredibly important that we have the availability of the regulations between the programs that allow for that collaboration to occur.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
You're welcome. The ever patient Mr. Ridgel.
I'll work my way up, Mr. Chairman, over time. But it's really, this is a fascinating discussion. I thank the chairman and I thank you all for being here. Let me just first say very quickly that indeed this is a shared value. And just this past Saturday night, I had the privilege of roasting the fellow that I ran against a couple years ago. But we were co-chairs of Horizons Hampton Roads for many years. And it's an early childhood intervention, really an educational program. Paul and I just have this bond of really trying to help young people, and especially kids at risk. So it truly is a shared value. A few things that were said that were very intriguing. I'd like to hit on these very quickly and then come back to something really of substance here is that Dr. Gilliam, when you said that teaching is a performing art and not an academic subject, that is intriguing to me. I just want to, it's not a question, but I'm going to hold on to that because I think you're right, and I think there's a lot of potential there. You also mentioned, I think I'm quoting you correctly, redundancies built in and difficult to navigate the silos at the federal level. At least that's a rough paraphrase. And what I'm going to do is start with Ms. Rauner. Ms. Rauner, thank you for being here. And I'm a businessman turned public servant here. And if I had to look at this, I'd say, you know, public education, this isn't some radical proposal here, but it's almost ready for like a leverage buyout. I mean, there's a lot of efficiencies that I think we could gain, which I think is a shared value. So could you at least comment on this notion that we can improve even what we have, maybe through streamlining or making the silos more logical or easier to navigate? Because this must be, I'm sure, common ground.
Well, again, I'll speak as a practitioner, and we do blend and braid funding streams, federal Head Start and Early Head Start programs, child care dollars, and state pre-K dollars. And it's an enormous effort when it happens at the program level. Everything that the federal government can do to support more efficient blending and braiding of funding streams is of great value to the people who actually have to put those programs out on the ground. And I would cite particularly the Early Head Start Child Care Partnerships as an example of an innovation that is blending and braiding funding at the federal level instead of at the program level. That's of great value to all of us on the ground doing the work.
Thank you. Dr. Gilliam.
Now, I would like to throw in maybe a concrete example of what Diana is talking about. We have some programs that are funded through CCDBG child care dollars, and that same program is a Head Start program, and that same program is in a public school that's participating in the state-funded pre-K system, which in many cases means that that program is going to be undergoing child care licensing, Head Start monitoring, public school, whatever happens in the public school level. Perhaps that state even has a QRIS system, quality rating and improvement system, and they're undergoing rating from that too. And on top of that, if they want to be accredited, then they're also subjecting themselves voluntarily to NAYC accreditation. I don't know when they have time to actually work with the children and families, because they're spending so much time in the monitoring, because every single funding stream has its own monitoring systems attached to it and its own administrative systems attached to it. The redundancies are not really redundancies that are non-planned redundancies. The problem that we really have is that most of our redundancies are actually planned redundancies. They're created redundancies that are in the system because every way in which these funding streams get braided in order to be able to create the programs in the way that the two panelists to flanking me are talking about create their own monitoring structures that then create extra weight and extra cost burdens on the system. If we could find a way to be able to reduce that, we would be able to fund a lot more quality and a lot more access.
Ms. Rauner, did you want to?
No, I was simply going to reiterate that in our own programs, we have an enormous amount of what we describe as indirect staff. Those are people who are not working with children or not working with teachers. They're working on paperwork. And particularly when we prepare for our Head Start, our now annual Head Start reviews, even though we were one of the exemplary providers that was supposed to get a five-year pass, it turns out what you get is a review every year.
I see that my yellow light is on, but Ms. Anderson, would you? There are some areas where you I would think would agree, but for the deficiencies could be made, right?
Yeah. Definitely, and I was thinking I agree 100%. In addition to that, our focus is really to think a lot about how are we understanding the outcomes that kids are achieving and benefiting from this blended quality. And to me, when we are able to understand and celebrate those outcomes, we have a better idea that these were investments that were wisely made.
Thank you. My time is up. Chairman Rogers charged us when we first started with trying to find redundancy and things like this, and that this is common ground. I thank the chairman very much, and thank you all for being here today and your testimony.
All right, you always get extra time when you cite the big chairman, so it strikes me just listening to the discussion and thinking through all the challenges associated with different funding streams, Oh, I'm sorry. I was getting ready to move ahead, and I hadn't realized that Lucille, you'd come, so please forgive me. The gentlelady from California is recognized.
Thank God for staff.
Always smarter than members.
Ms. Andersen, 2 weeks ago, UC Berkeley released a study that found that Mexican-American toddlers with similar language comprehension skills to their white peers at 9 months old fall significantly behind by the time they are two. And studies show that this early gap only continues to widen throughout childhood, which, to Mr. Fattah's point, is really a concern to the future of this country, not just to the children, as we look to them to be our future leaders, doctors, teachers, and so on. I know that Smart Start Oklahoma has focused heavily upon closing the achievement gap for Latino babies and toddlers. My question is, what specific interventions and supports do you find most effective for closing the achievement gap in language acquisition skills in early childhood education for Latino children and other English language learners?
I'll give you one specific example in Oklahoma City of collaboration that is occurring with our Latino clinic and the home-based McVee-funded programs in that clinic. While some of our home visiting services are seeing some challenges with enrollment, we cannot put enough providers at the Latino clinic to meet the needs of the families that are seeking the services. So providing culturally appropriate home-based supports to parents that while you're coaching them on strategies to talk to their children, to read to their children, we have an initiative we call Reading Begins at Home, and we provide books for children who are receiving home visits. We get feedback from Latino families that I didn't know it was important for me to start reading to my child when they're a baby. I thought they learned to read when they got into school. Dad's now reading with the baby because we have developmentally appropriate books. We buy books that are bilingual so that both families, no matter what their language is, can read. So implementing programs like that and making sure that they are meeting the culturally appropriate needs of Latino families, we have found to be most successful. Providers that are able to understand and relate to parenting styles of their culture has proven to be incredibly successful.
May I add to that? We have found in research of our EduCare schools, the Frank Porter Graham Institute at the University of North Carolina has found that children, English language learners, are particularly benefiting from early programs that begin at an early age. So we see in our network that English language learners who begin before age one, by the age of three, are performing in English as well as in Spanish, as well as their at national norms. So what we find is that if we begin early, those children catch up and learn English much, much more quickly and enter kindergarten with language skills at national norms.
Yeah, there's a lot of research to support that.
Okay. Dr. Gilliam, you have authored research showing that a significant number of young children are denied the opportunities preschool affords for one reason, that they have been expelled. In fact, you found that preschoolers are three times more likely to be expelled than children in kindergarten through 12th grade. Even more troubling, according to a March 2014 Department of Education report, expulsions and suspensions are greatly disproportionate to boys and African American children. Since research shows that low-income children who are more likely to be children of color gain the most from high-quality preschool, what impact do these expulsions have on our federal investments in early education? Why are young children being expelled at such a high rate? And what policies can we pursue to reduce the number of children being expelled?
With the gentlelady, can I just add to that? Why are these kids getting fired?
What is it?
Expelled.
Is it the kids? Is it the teachers? Is it the system?
Yeah.
This is
a great question. I'm very happy that you raised this and that Ms. DeLauro added to the question. We could have a whole hearing on this topic alone. I'll try to summarize it in just a few words. There are more than three times as likely in state-funded preschool programs. When you're talking about child care programs, now it's about 13 times as likely as K-12. 39% of child care classrooms have experienced at least one expulsion in the past 12 months. That's a lot. It means if your child is in a child care program, your child's got about a 40% chance of being in a classroom with a child who has been expelled. That's a lot of expulsion happening. As to why it happens, we've looked at a wide variety of factors, and many of them really don't have much to do with the child at all. Teacher-child ratios. When teacher-child ratios and you have more adults or more children per adult in the classroom, it's a real clear relationship. Group size, teacher depression. Teachers who screen positive for depression expel at twice the rate of teachers who screen negative for depression, and job stress seems to matter even more. And if a teacher is depressed and has inadequate amounts of supports available to that teacher in terms of consultants or other people who can come into the classroom and work with the teacher, then the depression tends to convert into job stress, and as soon as the job stress happens, then somebody gets expelled from the classroom. It's a way to mitigate the amount of stress. Now, that doesn't mean that the child's behaviors don't have anything to do with it, but it means that it's also balanced against whether the teacher feels that teacher has the resources that in order to be able to deal adequately with the challenging behavior in the classroom. But positively, when we're able to provide a support in the classroom, and many of these are fairly low-cost supports, they're basically taking advantage of mental health providers that already work in the field, giving them a little bit of extra training, and then putting them in the classroom as consultants, the expulsion rates drop dramatically and behavior problems improve, not just in a way that impacts that one child, but changes the way in which that teacher is going to be teaching all the other subsequent children that teacher will ever have access to. In terms of the race issue and the gender issue, it is very disturbing that was found, but to be honest with you, that's what we found about 10 years ago. When we first released these reports in 2005, that African-American children were expelled at twice the rate of non-African-American children, boys about four times the rate. What concerns me the most about this is this. We talked in this one hearing here about the Perry Preschool Project, Abecedarian. We didn't talk about the Chicago Child Parent Centers, but that's the other cost-benefit analysis report that people use to justify early care and education programs. In many presentations, I've asked people what they know about the Perry Preschool Project sample. And it's amazing, people know the year, they know how many children, they know what city it was, Ypsilanti, Michigan. But consistently, I never get the answer that, and they were all black. And that's true. Every one of them. Abecedarian, 98% African American. Chicago Child Parent Centers, overwhelmingly African American. We have in this country purchased early care and education for all of our children on data that belong to African American children. And then when nobody's looking, we disproportionately expel them out the back door. And it creates two major problems. One is that it basically undercuts the investment potential in early care and education, because you're expelling from and removing from the program the children most likely to give you your return on investment. And two, it is just simply not fair, and it's not American, to use their data to create a program for all of us and then disproportionately expel them out the back door. Thank you for asking the question.
You wanted to respond.
May I just mention that in Oklahoma, we do use some quality funds from our CCDGB grant to support mental health consultation in child care centers. We have a statewide system network for that.
That's really disturbing. Finally my turn, okay?
It is your turn.
Okay, thanks. But great questions. Great response. Thank you. As I struggle with the sheer number of programs we have and the different funding sources, and you mentioned the different monitoring methods, and I'm struck that in part, I would assume this is because when we think about the federal role on K-12, those systems already existed. I mean, we didn't start them. We've been there to supplement them, to add, value added. We're not the main proponent. Early childhood, we were much more there at the beginning, so to speak, with Head Start. So So, you know, we're not used to, as Mr. Fattah said, creating universal systems from up here. We're used to doing value added, and we've almost created a system here where we're becoming, I would assume, the largest single provider of early childhood education. That may not be the case. But we all know, given budget realities, we're certainly not in a position to do what we would all like to do and expand these programs to the degree that we were hitting significantly higher percentages of young people. So given that hard reality, a lot of this, it seems to me, gets back to encouraging other people to participate, particularly state governments, you know, who, as you've all pointed out, increasingly see the value of this. And so how do we take the resources we have and use that to encourage and leverage, if you will, more state dollars so we're not the only provider here? If we could do more, I'd be more than happy to do more. But in the short term, we're going to have to encourage other people to make these kind of investments with us, particularly at the state level. You might want to take a shot.
Well, I'll try. I think the most important thing that the federal government does is it sets standards and expectations and accountability. Many states have invested over years and have been cobbling together state systems with state QRIS systems, kindergarten readiness assessments, training and mental health infrastructures, training infrastructures and professional development. Other states are really just at the beginning of that process. And so one of the most important things that the federal government can do is use its both its funding power but also its accountability power and investments to build strong, to support the development of strong state systems that can serve prenatal through age five in a multitude of ways, because we're never going to have a system like K-12 where there's one size that fits all. We know that some families need different kinds of things. So it seems as though the most important investments are those that really promote quality, promote accountability, and support the infrastructure that will drive quality over the long haul in the states.
What I would add to that is that there have been a few developments recently that I think are very promising. One of them not too long ago was that the person who's in charge primarily of Head Start and child care became interdepartmental liaison to the person who's primarily in charge of early childhood in the U.S. Department of Education. So that's Department of Health and Human Services and U.S. Department of Education at least admitting that they need to have their early childhood people working together. Early Head Start child care partnerships, an effort to take early child care, early Head Start and child care programs and get them to actually coordinate and work together so that the quality efforts that exist in early Head Start can actually be applied to the child care world where the vast majority of the children actually are. These, along with other efforts that we've had at the federal level as well as in some states to try to create a more cohesive system, I think gives us the greatest promise to be able to find our redundancies. Because when we create cohesion, that's when you will locate your redundancies. But we have to also then be willing to then take a bit of a surgical knife and remove some of those redundancies. I'm not saying that we shouldn't have monitoring structures. We absolutely have to have monitoring. I'm just not so sure that we need to have six different monitoring structures that some of these programs are all subjected to individually so that they have to go through every one of them. That's a level of redundancy that just doesn't seem very, very wise to me. But through the efforts to create greater cohesion among these programs, which is really something I think at the federal and state level we should be encouraging more of, that's where we're going to find the redundancies.
In Oklahoma, we have a strong history of not only pioneering early childhood programs, we also have a strong history of really working together with each other as a state. I staff a 32-member public-private partnership board that is comprised of half state agencies and half governor-appointed members to the board. And in the 5 years that I've tried to get 32 members to a board, I've never, one time, we didn't have quorum and we moved out of the Oklahoma City area. So we're interested in working together. We're encouraged by the partnerships that are occurring at the federal level, because sometimes it felt as though that was a difficult task for us to coordinate across the state when we had silos that were occurring at the federal level. Continued support to help states both collaborate with the federal government and collaborate with each program, early childhood services are across a wide variety of agencies. We're probably going to continue to be that way. That could change someday, but irregardless, if everything's under one umbrella or different agencies, it's important that all those programs work together to best meet those needs of different families.
Thank you. Gentlelady from Connecticut is recognized.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Just a couple of points. I want to say a thank you to Ms. Andersen, because I think you've described the use of these extended, and you all have mentioned the expanded partnerships and the value of doing that. And I think that that's helpful to us as we think about how we are able to, in the programming that we do, encourage that kind of a partnership effort. I just want to make one comment on this testing regime that was mentioned. I don't want it to go by, because not too long ago we had a school of thought that believe accountability in Head Start centers should be measured by standardized tests. That was debunked by researchers and questioned the practicality of testing young children. It was squashed by the Congress in the 2007 Head Start reauthorization. It has the unintended consequences that you have reflected. I want to just two pieces, and it's a yes or no. Are you incorporating trauma-informed services into your practices?
Yes.
Yes.
How can you not?
Okay. Thank you. I need to know that, and at some other point, I really would like to focus on how that, what you can share with us in terms of what we ought to be doing in that regard. Let me, we've talked a lot about states committing resources. State investments are unequal. They are very unequal. National Institute of Early Education Research 2013 Preschool Yearbook reports 10 states provide no support for public preschool. Recent Department of Education, nearly 60% of four-year-olds are not enrolled in public preschool. So when we listen to all of you today, that we've got like a Swiss cheese approach to what we're doing in providing high-quality early education. The unmet need is great, and so we have to fill the holes. So if we're serious, and this is an Appropriations Committee, if we're serious about that development of human potential, what do we do to bring our efforts to scale? States are making the case for more federal investments. 36 states applied for the preschool development grants. I think we were able to do 18. Mm-hmm. But there is a need from the state. So each application identified the need for an increased federal role. So what do we do about ensuring that it's not a scattershot approach, and that we are looking at this as a national need and not state by state, and then trying to piece together what we think is the right direction to go in. I'll just add this quick addendum. If we did something about special education funds and that we were dealing with that would take a hell of a lot of pressure off the states to deal with special ed. Federal government has never met its 40% commitment on that effort. We're about 16 or 17 or 18% at the moment. I want to talk about how we address this as bringing this program to these programs to scale federal level. What your thoughts are? How do we do it? And what can this committee do?
I think I would start with making sure that we keep the pressure on the system to create more cohesiveness. The Early Head Start Child Care Partnerships is incredibly brilliant in its thought. Early Head Start or Head Start has about 20-25% of its allocations devoted to quality efforts and improving quality of the programs. Child care, on the other hand, much less. But that's where the vast majority of the children are. By creating those kind of cohesions where they can actually utilize funding across the system and to be able to build partnerships in there, that's probably where we're going to get some of the bigger bang for our bucks. Other things that we could potentially be doing is finding ways to encourage school districts to partner with Head Start. Schools are notoriously not good at comprehensive services, or at least many schools are. And many schools are not very good at parent involvement services, but these are hallmarks of Head Start. Why it is that we need to be trying to think about ways to make Head Start look more like the public schools and the public schools look more like Head Start, when in fact what we really should probably be doing is finding ways to get these two programs to actually cooperate and work together. I think ultimately that's a big part of the answer to your question. I mean, we have a lot of the building blocks already in place. We just haven't assembled them.
I would add that the preschool development grants are an excellent way for to bring programs, to bring states up to some higher level of engagement in early childhood education and capacity. So those are really capacity building grants that give states the opportunity, depending on their own stage of development, to move towards a more comprehensive system. They provide services, but they're also, in our state, there are also opportunities for us to bring early childhood mental health consultation into all of the programs that we work with. It's an opportunity to have the school districts begin to do full day, full year programming, which we know is important.
Talk about, right, full day.
And all of those things, again, that's where the federal government can really push states to become more engaged and to build their own systems.
I think, just to build on that, giving each state, kind of meeting each state where they are. As you said, we are all at a different place. We all have a different amount of state investment. In Oklahoma, we have a tremendous amount of philanthropic investment into our early childhood programs as well. And so providing us that flexibility to fund where we have gaps is probably most beneficial to our state.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have to dash because today is Equal Pay Day, and I have a commitment of the Department of Labor to be there. But if I could just say thank you to all of you. We didn't get to full day. We didn't get to some other things. This has been a most enlightening effort today, and we'll look forward to just tapping your brains to help us to come up with the kinds of systems approach that will help to make a difference for our youngsters today. You really are doing the Lord's work. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Gentlelady from California is recognized. Oh, Mr. Fatah is recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Dr. Gilliam, I want to thank you for your comments about the circumstances when we factor in these the question about race, but I want to put it in a different perspective. When Rose and I had this gathering a few years ago, Mr. Chairman, the father of Head Start was there, Mr. Zigler. He put up a chart and he showed something. He said that America would be surprised to see, which is that it holding constant for everything else, the childhood would do exactly what we would want them to do, graduate from high school, go to college, and going to graduate school, was an African-American male. Now, that's not the picture we often think about in terms of expected outcomes in our country, but I do think that it adds to your point about what's happening in terms of the data, and it adds to the chairman's insistence that we spend some time as appropriators kind of grappling with the broader implications of what we're doing. So I want to thank the chairman. Thank you for your comments.
Thank you very much. I too want to follow up on this issue with regard to the expulsion of young people, primarily African American boys, in preschool, which when I read some of the studies, I was shocked and outraged. And I think this really, once again, sweeps race from under the rug and have to really deal with race head on. Oftentimes, we're accused of playing the race card when we want to talk about race. And I think if we're going to crack this school-to-prison pipeline, we've got to talk about institutional and systemic racism and bias. And I think this is a clear example of what we're talking about. And so I want to ask, how do you propose that we address this from a policy point of view and a systemic point of view when there are some who say race is not a problem and racism does not exist, when it's very clear that this is much of the unfinished business of our country? And I think this expulsion of African American young boys preschool is probably one of the most glaring examples of racism in our country.
Yeah, and I certainly can't state whether or not this is conscious racism versus it's
No, it may not be conscious.
Right.
You know, it's benign, it could be subconscious, it could be, but the impact and the result is racial bias.
Absolutely. It creates disparate results and outcomes at the end. And so as a result, we certainly have to think about it and treat it as a huge blight and problem that we have within our system. What we don't have is a lot of good data on exactly why that is. We are starting right now. We just received some funding just recently, private money, to start looking specifically at why exactly is it that African-American children and boys are more likely to be expelled. The challenge for a long time has been finding a funder who is willing to touch the topic. But it's something that I felt really strongly for a long time that we needed to be able to get a better handle on and be able to understand better. It's just not an easy one to study. It's not easy. You can't just go up to a bunch of teachers and say, you know, do you think that you treat children differently depending on the color of their skin? You can't possibly get a decent answer out of that. And so as a result, you have to really think about ways that you can do these studies at a much more nuanced level if you're going to be able to ultimately end up with the kind of results that you'd want. I'm not even sure in the end what the intervention's going to be. I don't know if it's going to be another, like, a coursework on cultural sensitivity. I'm not so sure that we've had a whole lot of mileage out of that in the past. What it might boil down to is helping people be able to see their own behaviors and look at their own behaviors in a way that causes them to have to reflect. And that's ultimately, I think, the direction that we're heading towards. But it's, I mean, we're just starting to but the sad truth of this is we're just starting to go down this path.
But I would say that one of the things we do know is that programs and teachers need support. They need support for mental health consultation and behavior management. They need coaching, mm-hmm. and they need adequate ratios so that mm-hmm. all children can succeed in classrooms, even children who are either victims of trauma or children who are just spirited naturally. Which is challenging for parents and teachers at times. And we know that many of the programs where these young children are the most under-resourced programs.
Yeah, I mean, we could try to equalize expulsion rates by getting all the children to be expelled at the same number. And I suppose that's how you get rid of disparities. And if that's the case, then the number that I would choose is zero. That really we should not be expelling any of the children from our preschool programs, because I can tell you this, the child that's being expelled is the child that's most in need of the program. That's the child that's going to give you the return on the investment. You're basically undercutting the value of your investment by expelling children. It's like kicking sick people out of hospitals. You're not going to cure very many people if all the sick people get kicked out.
I would just like to add that in Oklahoma, due to the way that we collect information on children in our child care programs or in a Head Start or even a pre-K program, I don't have the data that I could tell you if African-American males or females or Latino males or females are being expelled at higher rates than children who are Caucasian. We don't have that information.
Okay, but I think many states have that information, and I think many studies have borne this out.
Yeah, actually, many states, unfortunately, don't have the information. The first time that it was collected was in 2005 when I did a study, and it was a study that wasn't even about preschool expulsion. It was a study about state-funded pre-K programs and the way in which they're implemented and whether they look like the state policies and what things give rise to better policy adherence. Is it per-child spending and things like that? And I just threw in some questions about expulsion. That was the first time anybody had ever collected this, and it wasn't until 9 years later that the U.S. Department of Education started collecting it, in large part because of some pressure that was placed by a member of Congress to start collecting that.
Well, Mr. Chairman, I think it's really very important that this committee somehow weigh into this issue, because when you have this disparity, you know, these racial gaps existing in our country with young preschool mm-hmm. children. Our national federal government has a responsibility to these children to make sure that they are treated fairly and tax dollars should go to insist that there's some equity and some justice in this. And so, Mr. Chairman, I would hope this committee could kind of discuss what we would want to do as suggestions and recommendations as a committee to begin to address this. Thank you very much.
Gentlelady makes a really good point, which she's made in other contexts before, and I couldn't agree with you more. I'm going to turn to Mr. Harrison a second, but just I'd like to work with you on that. And certainly, you know, pushing more money toward research. Pretty shocking to me what you just told us, that nobody had really looked at this, that you almost stumbled on. I mean, that happens, but one would have thought there would be a greater level of sensitivity just given the history of the country. You know, I also see these things with Native American kids, frankly, particularly on reservation settings. And it's another population that tends to be overlooked and forgotten. It's pretty substantial, obviously, in our home state, but not in very many states. But the same, if you look at educational attainment or success in school, very low statistics, very poor in terms of graduation rates, you know, going on to college, lots of trauma, lots of alcoholism, drug abuse. So same thing, we've probably overlooked those kids as well, but the gentlelady's point's well taken. I'd be happy to find ways we can work together on that and sort of encourage our government, which I think wants to do the right thing, to actually focus and get it, start getting it done. With that, Mr. Harris has done a valiant effort to get here before the end of the committee. We're all juggling multiple hearings, so please forgive us as members come in and out, but I appreciate very much that my friend made time to come, and I want to recognize him for whatever questions
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll be brief. You know, a concern of mine has always been that if we're going to undertake this kind of expenditure, and, you know, the President's recommendation for $75 billion, I mean, up until now, my understanding is Head Start, total federal contribution to Head Start is $180 billion since Lyndon Johnson. So this is a tremendous increase in funding. And yet, you know, the evidence that there are long-lasting effects, the way in the few studies that have been done, really is pretty lacking. I mean, look, just honestly, I mean, I don't know why. I mean, it kind of would make intuitive sense that if you start education earlier, you know, you give a child an early pre-K education versus a child who doesn't, that, you know, by third grade, the one who got the earlier education should be better, but it's just never been borne out rigorously. Which makes me think, based on the last couple of observations made, that, you know, maybe the, you know, the President's attempt is to expand it, make it available to kind of everyone, instead of focusing really on the children in whom it makes a difference. Is there an indicator, are we getting smarter in figuring out in which child it really makes a difference, whether or not you have an early, you know, early education? Any of you? I mean, do we know?
Yeah, I'm happy.
Is there good data to show us? Because, again, instead of expanding it to everyone, mm-hmm. you know, it seems to be more efficient to say, okay, these are the children whom we've demonstrated that it actually makes a difference. And some children, whether you're lower middle income, you know, if you come from, my personal feeling, you come from a good family background, you're low income, it probably makes a lot less difference than, you know, what if you come from a different family background. Yeah. Is there data?
Yep, there's a lot. There's a lot of data. It's not the data that a lot of people talk about an awful lot because it involves people, therefore it's nuanced. Mm-hmm. You know, so it's a bit of a nuanced answer to the question. We know that the children who benefit the most from early care and education programs are the children who are most at risk. And it is a clear relationship. The more at risk you are, the more you actually benefit from it. And in large part, that's because the child stands more to benefit from it. And it's also due in part, we think, to the fact that the early education stimulation that's being provided in the program is replacing more. It has more of a replacement option than for more advantaged children. So more advantaged children are able to have parents who read to them, take them to the zoo, take them to the museum. Our many disadvantaged children, they don't have anything like that at all. And so whatever level of stimulation they're going to get from their program is going to be displacing a lot of lack of stimulation within those children. That's what we really think is causing that. But the part that makes it nuanced is this. We also know that when low-income children are in a preschool program with children who are not low-income, middle-income children, upper-middle-income children, those low-income children, in comparison to other programs where it's all low-income children, the low-income children in the mixed SES groups tend to gain more on language skills. And if you spend any time in preschool programs, the reason why seems pretty clear. It's because the majority of the language that the children are hearing is not from the teacher, it's from the other children. And so if you want to augment the effectiveness of the early education program on young children's development, segregating and creating a program just for the poor isn't typically your best way to do it. And in many cases, when we create programs just for the poor, they end up being poor quality programs.
Let me just interrupt you for a second, because this is not about poverty. It's not about how much money you bring home. Mm-hmm. It's about whether your family at home will spend time. You know, it doesn't cost to read a book to a child. And so, you know, we use low income as some proxy. It's not a proxy. You know, what we're really talking about is identifying those identifying those households. I'm sorry, I just had to interrupt because, you know, we say low income as though low income is a pox on a child. Yes, it's associated with worse outcome, but I know many people of very modest income whose parents, you know, who will read to a child whose child will read by second grade or read by third grade and who go on to do great things. So just to wind up on the point you specifically make, it makes sense that there would be some incremental benefit of having that disadvantaged child and I'll use the word disadvantaged instead of low income because that's really what we mean, disadvantaged educationally. I can see where that would help to be in a class with less disadvantaged children or non-disadvantaged children, but to expand it to that group is expensive to bring in those folks. Those children don't get the same benefit. And then the question is, you know, how much of an incremental benefit is there for that? You know, and you're right, it's very nuanced, so I appreciate your answer, and I thank the chairman for your indulgence in letting me come in at the last minute and ask a question. It's a very complicated situation, and we really do need to take care of the children who, unfortunately, don't get the care they need at home that would, you know, and that's what we're trying to do. We're trying to replace, I think, you know, let's just be honest, we're trying to replace education at home.
Yes.
Can I just step in there for just one second? Because we are trying to replace education at home only to the extent that the environments in which children whose parents are working all the time tend to be pretty disadvantaged environments. And I have to speak personally here from my own research of going into family childcare homes, which is where most low-income children are. And those are really, in many cases, that's environmentally induced mental retardation. Those are kids who are sitting in environments where no one's talking to them, the television's on all day, and that's an environment in which we see the achieving gaps opening up over time. So we're not really replacing parenting, we're actually thinking about creating stimulating environments for those children as opposed to those warehousing environments, but we're also in Head Start and other programs thinking about coaching the parents and supporting the parents to be better parents, to understand the importance of reading and talking and cuddling with their child. And those are things that we know these programs are very effective at doing.
Good. Well, thank you very much.
Earlier, when we were talking about poverty, I made the point that it's really not, in very, very similar to what you were saying, Dr. Harris, it's not the poverty, it's the things that often go with the poverty that causes the challenges. And effective early care and education programs find ways to be able to ameliorate those things that often go along with the poverty. But regarding creating universal access to programs, there's nothing in any rule book that says that the children who are middle class or upper middle class would have to go to these programs for free. They could be on a sliding fee scale, maybe even on a full fee scale, because the families would need it and value it for child care, but their participation in the program would save us from having a segregated program.
Sure.
One of the last things we want to do right now in 2015 is to create a new segregated child care program, segregated early education system by having a program just for poor kids. You know, so if we can find a way to be able to open up the enrollment, but in a way that doesn't cost the system through having sliding fee scales, I think that'd be the way to go.
Sure. No, thank you very much, and thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, and thanks for making the effort to get here. Just in conclusion, first of all, thank all three of you for your testimony and for the discussion. It's been very helpful, and to this last point that was made, I think one of you, it may well have been you, Ms. Andersen, but one of you used a wonderful phrase. Just think of this as a two-generation program, because it really is about not just the children themselves, but changing parenting behavior, too, and the contrast you drew between the two parents and the two outcomes was pretty eye-opening, and I think that's something we have to think about when we look at these things. But it is a complex problem. It is hard to know exactly what to do and limited resources. So thank you for sharing your expertise to educate the committee a little bit. We'll probably be calling on you for additional ideas and thoughts as we go forward. We never have enough money on this committee to do all the things everybody wants us to do and that we would like to do ourselves. So we really need the help in terms of deciding when we know what the numbers are, what makes the difference? You know, where can we actually leverage those dollars, encourage other people to participate, and get the most out of them we possibly can? But again, thank you for your work. Collectively, you've changed and are changing, I'm sure will continue to change, thousands of lives, all for the better, and all that, as Mr. Fattah said, benefit this country globally, as well as obviously helping the individuals involved. So again, we're very grateful for your participation, and we're adjourned.
Thank you.
Thank you.